Hello, everyone. My name is Brandon Burk, and I would like to thank you for taking the time to view this presentation. I'm a registered respiratory therapist that specializes in adult critical care. I have a master's degree in respiratory therapy from Northeastern University in Boston, and I'm currently the program director for the Respiratory Therapy Program at Ozarks Technical Community College in Springfield, Missouri. Now let's just briefly cover our objectives for this presentation. We're going to state the primary purpose of the American Association for Respiratory Care's clinical practice guidelines for suctioning. We're going to describe shallow suctioning and how to select the correct catheter size. We're also going to identify the correct pressures for suctioning and state how to set pressures correctly on the vacuum regulator. This guideline being discussed was printed in Respiratory Care Journal in 2022. It actually was published in February of this year, so it's very current. Respiratory Care is a peer-reviewed scientific journal, and the guidelines are evidence-based. The authors compiled 105 different studies to formulate the recommendations that were printed in the article, and I would encourage you to visit their website, aarc.org, to read this article for yourself. The main reason why these guidelines were produced and published was to try to prevent unintended and potentially adverse consequences from happening during the suctioning procedure. The two primary adverse consequences that we'll talk about today are, one, direct trauma or injury to the airway tissue itself, and two, a reduction in lung volume, which is also called atelectasis. First, allow me to describe the mechanism that causes airway trauma during suctioning. The way that I was taught to suction someone when I was in school was to advance the catheter until I met resistance, or the patient began coughing, then withdraw it a few centimeters, apply the suction, and withdraw the catheter slowly. Does this procedure sound familiar to you? The inherent problem with this procedure is that the suction catheter is significantly longer than the endotracheal or tracheostomy tube. So when the catheter contacts airway tissue and the suction is applied, the catheter can adhere to the airway wall and cause damage. You can see the ulcerations from a photograph taken from a bronchoscopy on the right. So when we apply suction pressure and withdraw the catheter, while it's actually adhered to the tracheal tissue, it can cause a tear or an ulceration. Because the airway is highly vascular, bleeding is also likely to occur, and due to this injury, the inflammatory response begins, which can lead to infections as well. In my practice, I've frequently seen patients that have required intubation and mechanical ventilation develop blood tinges in their sputum, especially if they've been intubated for several days. When this occurs, it's likely due to oversuctioning over that period of time. Atelectasis is a common condition in patients receiving mechanical ventilation, and we could potentially exacerbate that problem when we suction. Obviously, suction catheters are connected to a vacuum, which generates negative pressure. When this is applied, we are literally suctioning air out of the patient's lungs, potentially leading to further derecruitment of aerated lung tissue. On a chest x-ray, black is air and white is tissue. As you can see on this x-ray, the lower half of both lungs are white and hazy, signifying that there is non-aerated lung tissue or atelectasis. So now that we've discussed the two main adverse consequences of suctioning, let's talk about the ways we can combat them. First and foremost, we should only suction patients when there's an indication to do so, and we should never do this routinely. I know that some clinicians will suction patients during every patient assessment, whether there's an indication or not, and this is not good practice. There needs to be clear evidence that secretions are present before we suction. Some examples of evidence that secretions are present are, one, you can visualize them in the airway. Two, you can auscultate the chest. The breath sounds that you hear are ronchi or coarse crackles. Three, when you palpate the chest, you can feel the vibrations of secretions in the airway. And four, there's a sawtooth pattern on the ventilator graphics. One exception to this is the need to obtain a sputum specimen for lab culture and sensitivity testing. Next, let's talk about catheter depth. How far should we insert the catheter into the artificial airway? Historically, as I discussed previously, clinicians were taught to perform deep suctioning, where the catheter was advanced until resistance was met and the patient began coughing. This response is a direct result of a reflex from bumping the catheter into the carina, the area where the trachea bifurcates into the left and right main airways that supply those respective lungs. This technique basically guarantees that the catheter will come into contact with airway tissue. Additionally, contacting the carina can cause cardiac arrhythmias as well. Shallow suctioning is simply inserting the catheter only to the end of the endotracheal tube by matching the length markings on both the suction catheter and the endotracheal tube. So what I have here is a standard 7.5 millimeter endotracheal tube and a 14 French suction catheter. And what you'll notice is as you insert this catheter, if you bury it all the way to the hub, you see there's several centimeters that are sticking out of the end of the tube. And you're guaranteed that that's going to come into contact with tracheal tissue. It's probably going to go into the right main stem, or it might even kind of get bound up on itself again. So rather than doing it that way, what you should do
is insert the catheter, noting that there are actually centimeter markings on both the catheter and the endotracheal tube. And when you match those up, you'll see I have matched the 28 centimeter markings up, and you'll notice that the tip of the tube is just right at the end of the catheter as well. So this makes sure that you're not going to come into contact with tracheal tissue at all.
To quote the 2010 CPG, the use of shallow suction is suggested instead of deep suction based on evidence from infant and pediatric studies. Shallow suctioning is recommended to prevent trauma to the tracheal mucosa. The 2022 CPG states, since that guideline, no new evidence convincingly impacts that recommendation. The neonatal and pediatric population has been suctioning this way for many years. While we tend to treat pediatrics and adult patients differently, there's no difference in the actual anatomy of the airway tissues. So it begs the question, why should there be two different standards for suctioning then? Another important aspect to consider is the size of the suction catheter in relation to the size of the artificial airway in place. The CPG states that a suction catheter should occlude less than 50% of the inner diameter of the airway in children and adults. If a catheter that's too large is used, it can create a significant amount of airway resistance that can potentially lead to airway obstruction. This can pose a major problem because the mechanical ventilator will have a difficult time ventilating them during the suctioning procedure. If we are suctioning the patient in this scenario, it's likely that air will be suctioned out of the lungs at a faster rate than the ventilator can replace it, which will lead to atelectasis. A good rule of thumb when deciding which catheter size to use is multiply the inner diameter of the endotracheal tube by 2, then use the next smallest size catheter in French. So if your patient was intubated with a 7.5 millimeter endotracheal tube, you would simply multiply 7.5 by 2, which is 15, then use the next size down, a 14 French. Just to note, suction catheters are sized in even numbers only. For example, a 10, 12, and 14 French. Here's a table matching the appropriate suction catheter size with the endotracheal tube. Again, as long as you know the rule of thumb, you should always select the proper size to avoid complications. The final point of emphasis from the CPG that we'll discuss today is suction pressure. The CPG states that suction pressure should be set as low as possible to effectively clear secretions. A negative pressure of less than 200 millimeters of mercury in adults is recommended. As a general rule, suction pressure should be set according to these criteria. Adults, negative 100 to a negative 120, pediatrics, 80 to 100, infants, 60 to 80. And again, you can go to negative 200 in adults, but never more than that. In my experience, suction pressure is seldom even a consideration when suctioning a patient. Many times a suction canister will have more than one device wide into the suction regulator, and more often than not, the oral Yankauer suction is on the same regulator as the inline suction catheter. And while that might make practical sense, an oral suction can be used with full wall maximum suction pressure. And the reason for this is because the inside of the mouth has rigid, robust tissue that is accustomed to wear and tear of eating, brushing your teeth, etc. A suction catheter designed for artificial airway suctioning should never be placed on full wall suction pressure because that tissue is not robust and complications can arise as a result. So how many people know how much pressure full wall vacuum actually provides? Full wall vacuum can actually be as high as negative 635 millimeters of mercury. We should never use full wall vacuum pressure to suction an artificial airway. So let's take a look at the pig lung to demonstrate this.
So when you power the regulator on, the major problem with this is that if you have your tubing open to the atmosphere like this, as you increase the suction pressure knob, you'll see the pressure is going up, but at a certain point it stops increasing. So even if I turn the vacuum regulator further, the knob, it doesn't go up any further. But as soon as you occlude the end of the tubing, you can see that it goes up to full wall vacuum pressure, which as we discussed is as much as 600 plus millimeters of mercury. So now what I'm going to demonstrate to you is if you were to set this up on a patient that's being ventilated through their suction catheter, you'll be able to see what happens to the lung while it's being ventilated. So I'm just going to insert the catheter here just like we normally would. So for this suction procedure here, on the next breath I'm going to demonstrate this. So right now I'm going to apply suction. And what you can see is that how quickly those lungs completely de-recruit and you cause a massive amount of atelectasis. And then it takes the ventilator a lot of time to recover from that. So our patients are going to become hypoxemic. They're going to have potentially dysrhythmias and things like that, and we have a lot of problems that are resulting directly from over-suctioning.
As you can see, using full-wall vacuum can significantly de-recruit the lungs in a very short period of time. and we could be causing harm to already critically ill patients. Now that we've discussed what the suction pressure should be set at, how do we actually ensure that the pressure is set appropriately? The CPG states that the negative pressure must be checked by occluding the end of the suction tubing before attaching it to the suction catheter and prior to each suctioning event. This procedure is referred to as occlude to set.
So now I'm going to demonstrate how to properly set suction pressure using the occlude to set technique. What you're going to want to do is go to the vacuum regulator and remove the tubing from the appliance that you're using. Put your thumb over the end of the tubing and pulsate that as you're decreasing the pressure on the regulator. And wherever that it is that you want to go to, so if, let's say for this example that I'm wanting to get to 140. So I'm going to just keep pulsating and adjust that until I get to the 140 mark. Suction pressure should be starting at about 100 to 120, but go no more than 200. And right now it's set at about 140 or so. So I'm going to apply suction here. We're going to insert the catheter into the lung. And now on the next breath, I'm going to begin. So right now, you can see now the ventilator has a little bit more time to put more air into the lung as we're doing the procedure, rather than removing all of the air from there causing atelectasis, which is going to be much more effective at preventing those hazards from happening while we're doing that procedure.
You must remove the suction tubing from the catheter and occlude the end of the tubing with your hand. While occluding the tubing, the regulator is adjusted to the appropriate pressure for the specific patient population. If you do not occlude the tubing, it leaves it open to the atmosphere, and the regulator will measure the pressure relative to the atmosphere. This will be much lower than when the system is occluded or closed, so to be accurate and to set a pressure limit, you must occlude to set.
Ohio Medical actually has patented technology. It's called push to set. And rather than using occlude to set, you can actually keep your appliances all intact. You don't have to take any tubing away. And what you would do is power on the device. And then once you have the device powered on, now you can't even turn the knob without pushing the button in. So once you depress the button, now you can adjust the suction pressure. And as you adjust it, it's already done the occlusion procedure for you. So as you can see here, it makes it very easy. I can just adjust this and say I wanted to set it to 140. As long as I have the button depressed, now we can go to 140. So it does that step. It takes a complete occlude to set procedure away from that, and now it makes it a lot easier for the clinicians to do that without having to move to the back of the bed. So now that I've demonstrated how to do the push to set procedure, we have the pressure set for 140, and we're going to demonstrate what that looks like when we suction the pig lungs here. So you see I advance the catheter, and on the next breath, you'll notice that there's still a small amount of volume loss there, but as I withdraw the catheter for that procedure, you'll see that the ventilator is able to recuperate much more quickly so that you don't have near as much volume loss as you did while using full wall suction pressure.
I realize that this presentation has been about all the negative things that can happen during suctioning, but it doesn't have to be a disaster. We just need to follow some precautions to ensure that this necessary procedure is performed safely. Again, first we need to make sure that there is an indication to suction. Any hazard of suctioning can be avoided by not suctioning at all if there's not an indication. If suctioning is indicated, we should pre-oxygenate the patient to prevent hypoxemia and cardiac dysrhythmia during the suctioning event. We should only shallow suction to prevent airway trauma. To prevent atelectasis, we should either occlude to set or push to set suction pressure, use a pressure of less than 200 millimeters of mercury in adults, use a catheter that occludes less than 50% of the inner diameter of the airway, and keep suctioning duration of each event to a minimum of less than 15 seconds. Following procedure is the best way to avoid complications of endotracheal suctioning. I would encourage each of you to develop and implement an artificial suctioning policy and procedure at your facility, if you do not have one already. A policy and procedure, along with accountability, is an effective way to ensure that suctioning is being done safely. So to summarize this presentation, one, hospital vacuum can be very powerful. Suctioning an airway is not a benign procedure. Higher than recommended suction pressures and inappropriately large suction catheters can increase the risks or hazards associated with suctioning. And in order to guarantee that a pressure limit is set on a suction regulator, either occlude to set or push to set procedure should be performed prior to each suctioning event. I would like to thank you for watching this presentation.